Welcome and thank you all for coming today. This is actually the third in a series of talks that I've given here at APS that are focused on science communication. And in case you missed any of the past ones, which covered things like the science communication process in general and resources for if you want to get into science communication, as well as this year's talk, they are all available online at nicolesharp.com/talks. And if you haven't written that down yet, don't worry, it comes back again at the end. So, we as scientists spend quite a bit of time telling stories, but the way that we typically tell these stories is either by journal articles or by presentations that in many cases are not really accessible to anyone who doesn't speak our very specialized mathematical language, including some of the other people that you may be talking to even in the rooms here at APS. And I didn't want to pick on anybody for this, so these are examples of my own work during my PhD. And this is probably the kind of format that you're used to thinking of writing both papers and presentations in. You have some kind of an introduction. You motivate the work that you're doing. You talk about whatever methodology you're using, and then the results in the discussion. But this is perhaps not the best way we could go about telling stories, especially because when we do it for science, we're taught to remove ourselves from the story. So there is no storyteller. We're simply talking about the science, and the science should stand on its own. And that may be a sensible way for us to talk about science to other scientists, but it's not an especially good way to tell a story to general audiences. And in fluid dynamics, at least, if you sort of look at how a typical paper performs in one of our leading journals, in its first 1 to 2 years, you might get 100 or 200 downloads for a paper. And if you're lucky, you'll get a couple of citations. And that means that, you know, there's a handful of people in the scientific community who are reading and appreciating your work, but this does not a New York Times bestseller make. So it's reasonable for us to ask the question, how do people tell stories? What actually goes into telling a good story? And so for this, let's talk about fiction and what kinds of stories people tell there. There's a very famous type of story. Some people have called it even a monomyth, claiming that all stories come down to this, called the hero's journey. And if you try to look up how you break out the hero's journey into stages, there are a lot of different interpretations as to what the hero's journey means and exactly how it gets broken down and what events have to happen for it to truly be a hero's journey and things like that. We're going to make things a little bit simpler for our purposes, and we're going to consider 4 stages. And because probably like me, a lot of you are into some very popular stories that have been told over the years, I'm going to illustrate the parts of the hero's journey with a few traditional options, including The Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter, and Star Wars. And I promise you have never seen this many pictures from those movies at a DFD talk before. So, the hero's journey always has to start with the ordinary world. We have to see what the world is like before our hero becomes a hero. So we see Frodo and Sam in the Shire experiencing Bilbo's party. We see Harry Potter living in the cupboard underneath the stairs, having a not-so-perfect childhood. And we see Luke Skywalker just wanting to get his power converters from Tashi Station instead of having to take care of the moisture converters. And this is all very important so that we can see where they come from. And at some point, our hero gets a call to adventure, and they go on some kind of a journey that's going to transform them completely. And this is the stage where you might run into mentors, you might actually lose mentors, you're probably going to come into many obstacles. But the point is that you go on a journey that's going to change our hero, perhaps subtly over the course of the journey, but importantly. And so this is where we see Frodo and Sam setting out to try and get rid of the ring in Mordor. Harry Potter finds out that he's a wizard, and he goes to Hogwarts, and he discovers that he can make friends, and there's magic, and everything is awesome. Isn't that cool? And Luke Skywalker goes on a journey and tries to rescue a princess and stumbles into a battle between good and evil that's far larger than anything he could have imagined. And after this, we have some kind of a crisis, a revelation that kind of tests our hero and brings them to the point where you really recognize just how much they've transformed over the course of that journey. So in our case, that means when Frodo decides he's going to claim the ring, he can't get rid of it, and Samwise, who, spoiler alert, is the actual hero of The Lord of the Rings,
has to save the day and try and save the world. In Harry Potter's case, he discovers that his teacher has a dark alter ego on the back of his head. And in Luke Skywalker's case, his sort of moment of crisis and revelation is realizing he has to turn off his targeting computer and trust his connection to the Force in order to make the shot that will destroy the Death Star. And then after this important moment of crisis and revelation, we have our fourth stage, which is our return, which I think is a very important stage because you have to see just how far you've come for your hero from what things were like in the ordinary world. So in the case of The Lord of the Rings, we see Sam and all of the other hobbits return to the Shire, save the day, assuming that you're reading the book instead of watching the movie. And we ultimately see Sam with his family after having dropped Frodo off to go off into the West. In Harry Potter's case, they tweak it a little bit. So for example, the first movie ends here with the Hogwarts Express taking everybody back to their homes for the summer. And Harry's last observation is that he's not really going home because Hogwarts is now his home. And then, of course, Luke gets a hero's welcome at the end of Star Wars. So once again, we start out in the ordinary world. We have a transformative journey. We have some kind of a revelation and crisis that ultimately leads us to the return that shows us just how far things have come. Now, here's a crazy idea for you. What if we did this with nonfiction? Turns out, we can do it. So it usually starts out with something like, here's a strange idea that I'm going to introduce. So for example, maybe I want to talk about why it is that a golf ball can fly further than a ball of the same size and weight that's smooth. And if I go on a transformative journey, typically that's talking about the past and how we got to this point. So I might talk about D'Alembert's paradox and ideal flow and how we can't quite seem to resolve what the heck's going on unless we take into account viscosity and boundary layers. And so we have this revelation of what if we pay attention to the flow very close to it and consider viscosity there, and that is going to lead us to the important takeaway of what happens with boundary layer separation and how looking at this important key idea completely reframes our understanding of that original problem. So that's a very quick example for you, but there are actually a lot of places that this shows up if you go out looking for it. So if you're like me, you may listen to NPR a fair bit, and a lot of their shows actually, if you start analyzing the structure, use this kind of format to tell their scientific stories in particular. A really great example is Radiolab's Color episode, which there's a link to here in the slides, if you would like to take a look at that, or listen to it, rather. It also shows up a lot in PBS shows, both on TV and often on the internet. You can also see it showing up. I don't know how many of you watch video essays sometimes on YouTube. A lot of times people like to analyze media this way, and they will also very typically use this kind of format in order to help bring people through rather complicated non-fictional ideas. So these are a few places that you can look for where this might occur. Some of you might be feeling a little bit skeptical about this and wondering, like, does this really work as a possible technique for a presentation, especially in a scientific audience? And for you, I would like to point out this entire presentation was just presented as a hero's journey. So with that, I want to thank you all for coming. Once again, you can get a copy of these slides at nicolesharp.com/talks. If we're lucky, you might also get a copy of the video and audio. If you like my sweet FYFD merch here, you can find that online. And importantly, if you want to hear more about this kind of information and more about science communication, I am offering workshops. And if you are interested in finding out rates and topics and things like that for full day or shorter workshops, please contact me. Either see me here at the conference or contact me by email. So thank you all very much. Thank you.